the larger picture here, Don. We know that the US is the biggest ally of the Philippines, but at the moment, we also know that it's fighting two wars, one in Ukraine, one in Gaza, although not directly, but there are a lot of concerns about the strain on the resources of the United States. How significant is it for Japan to step up as an ally at this point when there are concerns that the US could not fight three or more wars?
Right, I agree with you. You know, it's quite difficult, even for the United States, the most powerful country in the world, to sustain a consistent level of presence, you know, in every part of the world. I think that's just practically speaking, right? But we have to understand Japan's role here is quite significant. Yes, some may view Japan as an extension of the U.S. alliance network, right? But it's also important to look at Japan's role as an autonomous force, right? An independent force of stability for the region. Japan is the only Asian G7 member, and as we can see from the recent summit that was held in Japan, Japan has endeavored, of course, to intertwine the mandate of the G7 to the security of the Indo-Pacific. So it's trying to be that position, you know, it's trying to be in that position that serves as a major pillar of the region. It's also an Indo-Pacific resident power. Right. So, of course, Japan's role is undeniable. And Japan's, you know, as I've mentioned, it is the largest investor, resident investor in the region as well. So I think there's no question commitment in facilitating that particular position in the region. But of course, it would be continued to, you know, it would face challenges, of course, given that it also has multidimensional interests. But of course, the Indo-Pacific, you know, particularly Southeast and East Asia, lie at the heart of Japanese foreign policy. So I think that that is the advantage that we have. The political will of Japan would definitely be consistent in this regard.
No, I want to understand, though, in terms of history of positioning in the ASEAN region, in the East Asian region, I want to understand the policy of Japan and why it's evolving now. Because in 1977, it did announce the Fukuda Doctrine here in Manila. It declared its resolve never again to become a military power and to strive to strengthen its relations with the nations of Southeast Asia. And of course, we know that that's part of the history of the role that it played in World War II. But are we seeing now a shift in terms of policy? Is Japan still sticking to the Fukuda Doctrine?
Right. I mean, that part is enshrined well in the Constitution of Japan to the point that, of course, there's also that domestic sentiment of not wanting to be more overtly militarily engaged throughout the world, right? I mean, that's another case, but we can see now that there's a change in the norms surrounding Japan's engagements, right? Japan is also aware that in order to preserve its interests, it would need to play a larger security role. And, you know, it is trying to find a middle way between not compromising what is stated in the Constitution, but at the same time, being proactive enough to engage as a responsible security partner in the region, right? And this is where we can see Japan's role as a capacity builder. And at the same time, Japan can also realize that, you know, the situation in the East Asian region in particular has become too complex to the point that it is impossible not to involve the security realm of engagement, right? And it's only practical for major powers such as Japan to engage in that regard, right? However, as I've mentioned, that there's also that that section in the Japanese domestic public, right, that also look at it as a sense of anxiety. But of course, the broader picture here is that Japan is not just trying to shift its position drastically. I think it's going to be a smooth transition based on what is taking place at the external level, right? But at the same time, it has to show its commitment. You know, it has to show its commitment at a time when the geopolitical dynamics of the region faces great uncertainty in the future, right? So it has to be proactive in that regard. So the question now is, how will it be able to balance both aspects, right? So we have, you know, we have the constitutional aspect and, of course, the evolving norms surrounding Japanese engagement, right? And you know, we can look at it based on the evolution of that norm, and we can see how that norm will eventually take place and shift domestic perception as well. But this is definitely not an overnight scenario. It would depend on how the external forces play out in line with Japan's interests as well. So it's both, the, you know, it's a balance between both external and internal factors when you talk about this.
And Don, you don't foresee any changes in this policy even if there could be a change in the future in the leadership in Japan. We know that, unlike the Philippines, there could be some changes in a matter of years, 2, 3 years in Japan, change in prime minister. You don't foresee any changes in the policy despite a possible change in leadership.
Right. I mean, if we talk about it based on the constitution, right, based on the legal documents, right, it would take a lot of time to reform, right? But there are obviously ways to express Tokyo's interest to play a larger role at the security realm without creating much of a fuss, in terms of that at the domestic level. We've seen it since Prime Minister Shinzo Abe. I mean, I told you the Indo-Pacific construct was largely a brainchild of the former prime minister. And Prime Minister Abe, since Prime Minister Abe, Japan's foreign policy began to largely shift towards a security-driven policy, right? But this should not be translated in a way that Japan is now revising its constitutional its responsibilities and its position, right? I mean, there are obviously ways in which Japan would be able to express and demonstrate its willingness to play a larger role in the defense and security realm in a way that is also in line with its interests and its constitution, right? So it's obviously finding that balance that we see now. And this has been taking place since Prime Minister Abe, right? So we could see that throughout the next prime ministers that took, that held power, that took their particular positions in Japan, we could see that trend continue, right? So I think we're looking into a smooth process, a smooth realization of the need to play a larger role in this regard, right?
All right, we'll definitely watch out for that visit today of Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida. Thank you so much, geopolitical analyst Don McLean Gill, for sharing your thoughts and insights this morning on Head Start.
Thank you very much.